Hi everyone, this is Marika from Herosphere, and today what I'd like to talk about is the biopsychosocial model. And in particular, we're going to talk about how this can impact how we train women with prolapse and what are some of the important considerations that we need to make when communicating with these clients in particular. First of all, what I want to say, and I'm sorry that my little picture is obscuring the top corner of the slide there, prolapse is not just a grade or not just a stage. So when we talk about this biopsychosocial model, we are going to consider the biology. There is some kind of damage to the structures that support the abdominal contents. We cannot ignore that fact. So the ligaments, the connective tissue, the fascia that's holding all those organs where they're supposed to be have been stretched or damaged, and those organs are slipping down towards the vagina. There are women who have what we call avulsion injuries as well, where the muscle is torn away from the bone, which again means that those women have lost some of that structural integrity that is holding all the organs in. And we describe prolapse by, in times gone past, the organ that was involved. So the bladder was called a cystocele, but these days we talk more about the anterior wall prolapse. And the stage or grade is really talking about how far that organ has moved down, either to within still the vagina or literally outside of the body. We need to consider the bio here because there is structural change. And for some women, we cannot overcome that structural change just with exercise or lifestyle modifications. So I do think it's important that we consider that the bio is important when it comes to pelvic organ prolapse. But what about the whole other side of things? What about that psychosocial side? We need to really consider the area of the body that we are talking about. So if we think about that homunculus in the sensory cortex of the brain, and we think about that map, there is a large portion that's devoted to the genitals. So we are going to have a lot of sensory input coming from the vagina and the tissues in and around that area. So we are going to get lots of input. So we do need to consider the fact that we are going to feel and be more aware of things in that area. We need to consider the mental health implications of having pelvic organ prolapse. And yes, sexual dysfunction can be an issue for some women, and that general feeling of being broken or something being not right. It can feel very uncomfortable for a lot of women. They might feel this dragging heaviness, horrible sensation, which can, again, if we're talking about all that wiring that's going up to the brain, can make women aware of it 24/7. And I will have clients who will talk about just, they can't get it out of their head. They're constantly aware of this sensation of just not feeling right. And some women will get out a mirror and will look at their prolapse and look for the lump and will literally monitor that area of their body every day. And so we're just kind of thinking about, well, what are the implications of this prolapse on her quality of life? What about when she can't go back to doing the things that she loves to do? So if she's a CrossFitter or she's someone who enjoys lifting heavy weights and she's been told you can't do any of that. What about the impact on her work, her occupational life, or as her life as a new mum? If she's being told you can't carry anything, and she says, "Well, I've got to get this pram and this baby out of the car and to an appointment. How am I going to do that if I can't lift anything?" Okay, so there's often mixed messages there as well, and we need to think about the reverse. So, how do the psychosocial factors influence the impact and the awareness of prolapse? So, if a woman has a lot of stress and anxiety, if she doesn't have a very strong structural support, if, you know, all of these things are going to impact on how that prolapse affects her life as well. And I guess one of the questions I've had in the last few years, which has puzzled me and fascinated me, and I think I'd be interested to see where research goes in the future, is why do women experience prolapse differently? So if two women with a grade 2 prolapse, and you can have one woman who is significantly affected by it, and it is not in her brain. This is seriously affecting her life, and someone who will barely even be aware that it exists. Why is this the case? And I think there's so much more that we need to know about prolapse. Is it because of different neural wiring? Does one woman have so much more input going into the brain, or does she have some areas of the brain that are just constantly bringing awareness to that area? And if she does, why is that the case? Do some women have different expectations? So when I had my women's health physio assessment postnatally, she just mentioned in passing, "Oh, you know, you've got prolapse." And I said, "What? What do you mean?" And she said, "Oh, don't worry. Every woman who has a vaginal delivery has some degree of prolapse. Yours is mild. It's not going to affect you." Now, how is that going to impact on me versus someone saying, you know, you've got prolapse, you know, you, this is really not good. You're not going to be able to do anything. You really shouldn't run. You shouldn't do your taekwondo. So what is the message that's been given to that woman, and how is that diagnosis given, and what were the expectations that were given alongside that diagnosis? So the language that is used in that case can actually have quite a strong impact as well on the outcomes for that woman. So is it purely biological? I would argue that prolapse is absolutely a situation where the biopsychosocial model comes into play. So how can our communication help? So we need to be very careful that we avoid catastrophization. When it comes to pelvic organ prolapse, these women are, I mean, they're often catastrophizing themselves. They'll go onto Google, read every disastrous thing about prolapse. So we need to help them step away from that catastrophization. We need to help her create a support network. She needs to know that she's not alone. So pelvic organ prolapse is really, really common. Many women live with it without much in the way of symptoms through conservative management, and other women do actually need surgical interventions. But whatever the case may be, we want her to know that she is not alone, and many women do live with pelvic organ prolapse, and that there is help out there for her. We also want her to create some long and short-term goals, and we really want to find out what can she do right now. We don't want to be giving someone a list of everything they can't do. Don't do this, don't do this. Like, what can she do now? What can she do right now that's going to give her some of those great endorphins that you get from exercise? What can she do right now that's not, we know that's not going to make her prolapse worse, that can make her feel good and make her feel like she's working towards her goals. We need to work really closely with the health professionals with these clients, and in particular the women's health physiotherapists. And we want to challenge some of the beliefs that are out there when it comes to pelvic organ prolapse. The rulemaking, a lot of it is not based on a lot of research. And we need to challenge the beliefs out there that women with prolapse can never run, can never lift, can never do anything. Everybody has such a different presentation. And what we want to really do is challenge those beliefs and try and create something that is individualized and really supportive and loving.